you. David, David, hey, hey!
A former Temptation was funeralized on June 10th, 1991, at Detroit's New Bethel Baptist Church. It marked the somber finale to a life that saw the highest of highs and the lowest of lows.
It's gonna open up on
I've got some.
A little over 7 years later, NBC aired the miniseries The Temptations that explored its namesake's decades-long saga from local Detroit acts to world-class international act, where he was betrayed by Leon Preston Robinson, a betrayal that, for better or worse, introduced him to a younger audience. This is extremely disappointing, as the miniseries got many key moments of the quintet's history wrong. I could devote an entire video about that miniseries and its relationship with the legacy of the Temptations, but this video specifically will be about the calamitous relationship it has with that of David Ruffin. The Temptations began as two groups in Detroit, Michigan. The Distance, formed by Otis Williams, and The Primes by Eddie Kendricks. One of the aforementioned groups disbanded and joined forces with the other and auditioned for Motown Records. The miniseries introduces the viewer to David Ruffin amid the above events.
Mary Wells,
as the Elgins, a primitive name for the Temptations, were outside their audition for Motown Records.
Melvin, y'all hook up with the Primes?
Yeah, it looks that way, don't it?
Man, y'all gonna kick some ass. What you calling yourselves?
The Elgins.
Elgins? Like the wristwatch?
Yeah.
Cool. Well, good luck.
All right, thanks.
The next time we see him is after the ousting of Elbridge Bryan in 1964. Following a performance of the Isley Brothers' Shout with the remaining temps, Jimmy and David Ruffin, where David did he was added to the lineup. David Ruffin had been vying to be a member of the Temptations since their early Motown days, but settled to be a drummer since they already had five members. As Eddie Kendricks put it,
well, Ruffin had been hanging out with us, following us around to get a job, but he wouldn't sing with us because there was five of us.
Right.
So he started playing drums.
What?
And he was playing drums with us and hanging around until something traumatic happened. And then when that happened, we just put him in the group.
He was just ready.
He was ready all the time.
This was not portrayed in the series.
Cool.
You know, Mama,
the next scene shows the Temps and Ruffin eating together, and it merely touches on his previous desires to be a Temptation.
I just really want to sing with y'all.
Well, there's gonna be a whole lot of singing. And we have some rules.
Hope not too many, because I ain't too good with rules.
In his rebellious nature. But it also hints at a sad childhood. Money.
Instead of paying up, she gave me to him. He had a whole lot of rules, too. Break any one of them, the strap came out. Seems like most times, strap just came out on his own, though.
Well, we don't have no straps.
Born in Why Not, Mississippi, Ruffin's father, Elias, was a preacher and a truck driver, while his mother, Ophelia, was a home worker. She died 10 months after having Ruffin. From all accounts, David Ruffin had a highly abusive childhood. The next scene to feature David is also somewhat based on truth.
Hey, Ruff, we're ready to go.
I'll be there in a second.
Something wrong?
No. Nothing's wrong. First time, everything's right.
At 14, he started on the gospel circuit and eventually began recording secular music. By the time he joined the Temptations, he had released a few singles of his own, none that found success. The success of The Way You Do the Things You Do prompted a tender moment between Otis Williams and Ruffin, which Otis Williams chronicled in his book, The Temptations. That moment inspired this scene.
First time in my life, I belong to something that's right.
It was just the beginning. It's just the beginning. Let's go.
What came next was a long, long list of hits. My Girl, co-written by Smokey Robinson, was Ruffin's lead vocal debut as a temp. It was a massive success, landing the group a number one pop hit.
And the birds in the trees. Well, I guess you say, what can make me feel this way? My girl,
my girl,
my girl, talking about my girl.
My girl. Ooh,
ooh. The next three singles released by the group, It's Great.
Like the snowball rolling down the side of a snow-covered hill. It's growing like the size of the fish that the man claims broke his reel. It's growing.
Since I lost my baby. My baby were all led by Ruffin and were all top 20 pop hits.
Personality contains more gold than any bank in this world could hold. My baby,
my baby,
my baby.
I will now turn my attention back to the miniseries, where immediately after scoring their first big hit, this happens. David buys a limousine. Not a fancy coupe or sedan, a limo. That move signals to anyone who has seen biopics what is to come. And boy, does it come, literally, in the next scene.
Touring. Whoever said success makes you the person you really are must have had David in mind. Because he started to become someone none of us recognized.
Go get that bitch.
Now that is Tammy Terrell, a young singer who would go on to find success doing duets with crooner Marvin Gaye. She and Ruffin were romantically involved, and the relationship was abusive. And now to what is arguably the most iconic scene in the miniseries.
Dave.
Love when I do that move, don't they?
Yeah, man.
Hey, fellas, how you doing?
It reveals two truths.
Treats, baby.
David Ruffin used drugs, cocaine specifically.
You need to go. Okay, Dave. I'll leave you boys a little sunshine.
Why don't you take that little sunshine along with you?
We're gonna be friends. Good friends.
You
around.
Boy, Norman just kept whipping us and whipping us the other day, huh? I don't think I can get any better, though.
That ain't the way I see it.
Oh, yeah? Well, hit me up.
Well, for one, you missed a very important meeting. Not to mention our last few sessions, I'm not even gonna count the rehearsals.
And was noticeably absent in rehearsals.
Well, maybe I don't need as much rehearsal as some other folks.
David, this can't go on.
What you got to say, Blue? That's right, Otis. Whatever you say, Otis.
Now, David, it's like this. Now, either you gonna straighten up, or we letting you go.
Blue, you all right with that?
I'll miss you, but not if you're hurting the group.
Hurting the group? I'm the best thing ever happened to this damn group.
Nobody's bigger than the group.
Y'all ain't stupid. I'm the one selling the records.
It also eloquently shows us that
ain't nobody coming to see you, Otis. You rich.
Now, to the massive lie. But first, context.
Because there is only one David Ruffin.
Motown had a lot of groups on its roster. Groups that made it big and naturally had lead singers. These singers grew in such popularity that Motown pushed them to the forefront towards the late 60s when doo-wop style groups began to fall out of style. The Miracles became Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, and the Vandellas became Martha Reeves and the Vandellas. And if things went Ruffin's way, the Temps' new name would be
David Ruffin and the Temptations.
But this happened an entire year after the time frame given in the series. The Supremes' name change to Diana Ross and the Supremes, which positioned Diana for a solo career, inspired his push for a new name. But that happened in the summer of 67, not the summer of 66.
What do you say?
That ain't never gonna happen.
Then I'm gone. Fellas, you know I'm just kidding, right? Come on, you know me. You know I always be kidding.
One thing the series does get right
fellas,
is his insecure
now.
Nature.
Lighten up, he's too uptight. Enjoy the fruits. I'ma see you at rehearsal. I'ma be there on time. I'ma be there before y'all. Bye.
At least, most of us did.
Where the hell's Ruffin?
Hey, you tell me, because I don't know.
Look, scenes like this are usually like inaccurate.
This is getting old.
Just imagine this happening in real life.
Otis!
I'm on my way. And I'm bringing you love is true, so get ready. So get ready. I'm gonna try to make you love me too, so get ready. So get ready, cause you're on.
The reason he was fired is much simpler. He missed a show, and it was just the last straw for the other group members. The following scenes with the group members vote on Ruffin's termination and David reacts to his firing underscores the contradictory nature of David Ruffin.
And you ain't even being a
finish the damn vote, Mel. In or out.
David, I need you to do this, please. Are you crazy?
I'm sorry.
Y'all are stupid.
David, please.
Get off me. Y'all ain't nothing without me. I made your asses. You can't fire me. Do you hear me? Do you hear me? Y'all can't do me like this! You ungrateful son of a bitches!
He was profoundly insecure yet possessed an almost narcissistic arrogance. The last important scene I will mention for a while comes when the Temps are performing Ain't Too Proud to Beg at the Fox Theater, and David does in actuality, Dennis Edwards handed him the microphone. The resulting conflict reignites the same tropes his characterization falls victim to.
I told you he was clean.
I don't care. I'm straight, man. Can't you see I'm straight?
You're straight. Listen to him.
Man, tell me I'm back in the group, man. Tell me I'm back.
No, you ain't in this group. Don't you get it? You blew it. The crowd went wild when he went on stage.
He's the one who blew it, Korn.
There are a lot of things that the movie does not mention. David Ruffin helped build Motown, literally.
And physically labor, I have built Motown with my hands. Yeah. His father was a contractor, and I lived with him and his mother.
Towards the end of his short time with the Temps, he pushed for an outside look into their finances. The Temptations gave David a second chance, something else not included in the series. Also, the series implies that there was bad blood between Dennis Edwards and Ruffin. And this is simply not true. But after he was dismissed from the Temps, Ruffin still had a contract to fulfill with Motown. So thus began, or really continued, his solo career. His first solo single after exiting the group, My Whole World Ended, was a top 10 pop hit and nearly topped the R&B charts in 1969. His second single, I've Lost Everything I've Ever Loved, did not fare as well. His album, My Whole World Ended, topped the R&B albums chart. His next LP, released 8 months after My Whole World Ended, in November 1969, spawned the top 20 hit, I'm So Glad I Fell For You. He released 2 more singles. You can come right back to me. And Each Day Is a Lifetime from the LP Motown refused to put out. In February 1973, they did, however, release David, which did well on the R&B charts, but tanked on the pop charts. One of its 3 singles, Common Man, managed to chart, albeit lowly, on R&B charts.
And
didn't have to worry about being a common man. You said, David, you don't have to worry about rising to the top.
His next album was his attempt to prove himself worthy of A-list producers after being denied access to them. Entitled Mean Rock and Roll Are Here to Stay, the album peaked in the top 40 of the R&B charts, and its two singles flopped.
Congratulations on your new album. I've listened to it quite intently, and I think it's fantastic.
Oh, I love it myself.
You got Norman Whitfield.
Norman Whitfield? Fantastic. It's been a good combination for a lot of years. Mm-hmm. And he produced the album. And the title tune off the album, title of the album is Me and Rock and Roll Here to Stay. Mm-hmm.
That's the song you're about to do now.
Right on.
And then.
This was I and young was my mind. Sometimes a man must live in darkness to appreciate light. I hope you understand where I'm coming from.
As disco swept the nation, Ruffin released his moderate take on the genre with Walk Away From Love, a top 10 pop hit.
Take the place of you. It's just a fear that builds within me every time you touch my hand, and a dread that shakes my body that even I don't understand. So I'm leaving.
The album, Who I Am, produced by Van McCoy, returned him to the upper echelon of the R&B albums chart. With this album and McCoy, he found his niche, disco-tinged up-tempos. His next album was an attempt to replicate Who I Am's success. Its lead single, Everything's Coming Up Love, was a top 10 R&B hit and should have charted higher on the pop charts as it stalled at number 49. His next album, Ruffin's last for Motown Records, In My Stride, spawned two singles, Just Let Me Hold You for a Night and You're My Peace of Mind. His next LP, So Soon We Change, spawned the single Break My Heart, a top 10 R&B hit. In 1980, he released his final solo LP, Gentleman Ruffin. Although he never achieved sustained mainstream success, he fared well for himself.
I know what it's like, you want me to leave. Take me clear from here.
Not too soon after the release of his final solo effort, there were talks of reuniting the Temptations. In 1982, despite troubles with the IRS and a cocaine addiction, Ruffin went on a reunion tour, The Temps. An album resulted and generated a Rick James produced single, Standing on the Top. This brings me back to the miniseries. Leon's Ruffin appears in a nightclub watching Eddie Kendricks perform. In real life, Kendricks and Ruffin were close. From this nightclub reunion, which I'm assuming is the late 70s, is where the reunion idea came from. The miniseries depicts the reunion, Ruffin's drug addiction, their induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and the death of David Ruffin. Out of all the things this miniseries gets wrong, it is the death of David Ruffin that is most abhorrent. Ruffin overdosed on crack cocaine in June 1991 in Philadelphia. He was taken to hospital of the University of Pennsylvania, where he was pronounced dead. His family was not immediately informed, so his body sat in the morgue until they were notified.
He had come off a tour with a briefcase full of money. No one is exactly sure what happened. Almost a week went by before the John Doe in the morgue was identified as David Ruffin.
The writers of this miniseries told what many a mother or grandmother would call a bold-faced lie. Although Leon embodies the character, how did this characterization affect the already tragic legacy of the real David Ruffin?
For all the world to see, a statue of a fool made of stone.
Because the miniseries is about the Temptations, it makes little mention of the career David Ruffin had after leaving the Temps. His first album signaled the promise of a successful solo career, but even then it featured histrionic ballads and mid-tempo songs. As Rebeat magazine put it, he sued Motown before its release, and after they lowballed him with lackluster material, he sued again, trying to free himself from his contract. What followed was a string of albums and singles that stuck to the middle rungs of the R&B charts. What the series does mention is his drug abuse. Consequently, viewers walk away thinking Ruffin was a drug-addicted, egotistical monster. He was more than his demons. And although the miniseries clumsily handles his nuanced story and personality, which according to the New York Times was reduced to a cat-like swagger, there is yet another chance to right this wrong.
And what a shot.
During my research, I discovered now, there is a Broadway musical about the Temps entitled Ain't Too Proud to Beg. Elijah Ahmad Lewis's performance as David Ruffin is the standout, and although admittedly I haven't seen it, Ruffin's characterization is described as charismatic in a Broadway World Review, a far cry from cat-like swagger. So maybe this generation will be introduced to a kinder, more realistic depiction of the troubled but talented man that was David Ruffin.
We love you, David.